saw with good to be in the house of God, to come round His Word. The Bible tells us the entrance of His Word brings light. And really that's talking about revelations of God that sharpens you in your spirit so you can have an understanding of how God wants you to live, what God wants you to do, who you are in Christ Jesus. So we're going to look at the Word of God. We're going to look at Acts chapter 4 and verse 13. This is what the Word of God says. When they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. And God will bless His Word to us this evening. Now, folks, I think one of the problems that is in the church today is that when we look at people in upfront ministries like the apostle, the prophet, the pastor, the evangelist, the teacher, we misunderstand the purpose why God gave these men as gifts to the church. And because of this misunderstanding, we see many today who simply try to copy the ministers, even becoming like them in speech and in their mannerisms. It's almost like they become clones or echoes of the person they follow. Well, the good news is this, that God never created you to be anyone but you. You're in fact the best at being you. No one else can be you. You're unique, you're a one of a kind, you're precious in God's sight. God really wants you to conform more and more to the likeness of His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, you could never be Smith Wigglesworth. You could never be Catherine Coleman. You can be like them in some ways. You can take some of the benefits of their life and apply them to your own. But you've got to be the person that God has destined you to be. The whole purpose of God placing ministers or ministry gifts amongst us is not so that we can copy them, but it's to equip the believers to bring us to a level of maturity and unity in the Lord Jesus Christ so that we can do the works of the kingdom, so we can advance it. It's so we can grow in the things of God, that the church is equipped to do the things that God has called us to do. So every time you listen to the Word of God, every time you hear the Word of God being proclaimed, every time you see a demonstration of supernatural power of God working through another believer, it really should encourage you to believe that you can have and you have got that same potential to move in the miraculous, because God is preparing you. He's actually equipping you for the life that He wants you to live in Him. So you can have the same kinds of works. Now I want you to understand that the anointing of God in every area of ministry can be imparted or transferred. We all know that it can be imparted through the laying on of hands. There is that transference, if you like, of the anointing of God. You see, if you as a believer associate with other believers, say you associate with people that have a prophetic anointing upon their life, then there will be an increase of that prophetic anointing within your life as well. You will find that prophetic words will start to come forth from you, that you'll be able to speak into the lives of other people as you yield to the person of the Holy Spirit. So dreams and visions will also start to flow from your life as you submit to the Holy Spirit. And as the Holy Spirit opens that revelatory realm to you, God wants to reveal things to you. And so even association with certain people, certain times of people, can bring impartation of the anointing of God into your life, into your ministry. We all know the Word of God says that those who walk with the wise become wise. So something of what they have rubs off on you. But it's equally true that bad company corrupts good character. So if you knock around, mix with the wrong type of people, influences that are not heavenly, influences that are not godly, will start to work on your life. But tonight I'm talking about just that impartation that comes upon your life through association. In Acts chapter 4, Peter and John, two of Jesus' closest disciples, it doesn't say in the Word of God that Jesus loved them more. You know, it might refer to John, the one that Jesus loved. But those were the ones that pleased him more because they spent more time with him out of all his inner circle. So sometimes as believers today, you can have people that are closer to Jesus. He doesn't love them more than anybody else, but he's pleased with them more because they care to come to him. And God wants you to be someone that desire him, have a passion for him, have an appetite for him above everything else. So Peter and John were part, if you like, of God's, Jesus's inner circle, the closest of disciples. And the Bible tells us in Acts chapter 4 that they were being questioned by the religious leaders of the day, the Jewish elders of the day, and they wanted to know by what power or by what name they'd been able to perform a miracle on a particular man who was crippled from birth. There are many men crippled from birth today. They're born into a bad situation. We're born into sin. We all inherit Adam's old sin nature. So we're disadvantaged from birth. But there's others that are born into the kingdom of God, but never really progress, never really learn to walk with the Holy Spirit the way they intend to do. They stay too close to where they got into the faith. And so there's always a danger of them falling out. We need to be people that press greatly into the things of God. So Peter and John had ministered to a man who was crippled from birth. And that man, when you know he received his healing, the Bible tells us that he went walking and leaping and praising God. He followed them into the house of God. So he was someone that saw in their life the presence, the power of God, something within them that he desired and he wanted, and he followed them to worship the living God. And when you bring a person to Christ, they're not to be following you as such, but they're to follow your desire, your passion, you know, your hunger for God, to pursue the Lord on a greater level. And that's what that man did. But the Bible is telling us that Peter and John are actually being questioned. So it's saying that really they were being questioned really about this man. Now, the Bible tells us that when the elders saw the courage of Peter and John, it says they realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men. And it says they were astonished and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. They took note of who Peter and John had associated with. Sometimes as parents, you might take note of who your children associate with. Well, God is interested in you associate with. And above anyone else, he wants you to associate with him, have fellowship with him. These educated men of the religious system of the day, these scribes, these Pharisees, these leaders, they took note of Peter and John because they were unschooled men. They were astonished and they realized that these men had been with the Lord Jesus Christ. And it wasn't only the fact that they saw the man who was healed, they also knew there was a transference of that supernatural power that Jesus had upon him into their lives. Otherwise, they couldn't have done the miracles that they did. But they also recognized the supernatural confidence and understanding of the Word of God. And we need to take that on board, that when you spend time in the Lord Jesus Christ, he imparts to you an understanding of the Word of God through the person of the Holy Spirit. He starts to give you. When I first became a believer, prior to that, I tried to read the Word of God. I could not understand it. The moment I became a believer and I started to read the Word of God, it started to make sense to me. What happened? God illuminated my spirit man and gave me that spirit of revelation and understanding to recognize his truth, to relate to that truth, and it was revealed to me in a package and in a way that I could understand through the Holy Spirit. So these particular leaders of Israel noticed in Peter and John, they now moved in the supernatural, they now had an understanding of the Word of God and a supernatural boldness and a courage even to address them. They were unschooled or ordinary men. They hadn't been to a Bible college like people go to today. They hadn't been to any school of supernatural. They simply spent time with Jesus. And I'm saying to you tonight that you don't necessarily need Bible colleges. You don't necessarily need these things. They're good, but sometimes people go to those places and they have all the faith and all the passion taken out from them. I'm saying you have to spend time with Jesus. And Jesus Christ will disciple you in the things of God. The Holy Spirit will start to minister into your life and he will show you even things to come. He will take the things of Jesus and make them known to you. That's what the Bible says. So as we spend time in his presence, he will illuminate your mind even if you've got no education. Even if a person couldn't read or write, spending time in the presence of God will start to transform their life. Not only can they receive a supernatural miracle to be able to read or write, but God will down information to them that he wants them to have and to know. When I became a believer, I've told you this before, but I started to read the Word of God from cover to cover. I didn't know any different. No one cared to explain that to me. that the Bible was a number of books. It wasn't just one you could read from cover to cover, but I read it from cover to cover. And I noticed in witnessing to people, I would quote things that I'd never even read. Where did I get those scriptures from? How did I know scriptures before I ever read them? I knew them because the Holy Spirit revealed them to me. And the Holy Spirit within you knows the Word of God. Never say that I don't know enough, because the Holy Spirit within you knows it all. And He will reveal, He's the only expert in the world today. He's the only one you need to be relying upon. So we will bring you revelations. So really, when you come to the Word of God, if you ask the Holy Spirit to illuminate things, it will do. And it will do that for you. And not only that, other people will be impressed with your Word of God because you correctly handle the Word of truth. Not impressed so your head can swell, but impressed so they can enter into the kingdom. And that's what God is looking for. So Peter and John were ordinary men. He hadn't been to a Bible college. He hadn't been to a school of the supernatural. He simply spent time with the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's interesting, really, that when Jesus began to teach, when Jesus taught the Word of God, for instance, in the temple courts in John chapter 7, he says the Jews were totally amazed and asked, where did he get such learning without having studied? So they're looking at the Lord Jesus Christ and they know His history. He's not studied, He's not been to one of their colleges, He's not sat under their ministry. No one's mentored Him, or really the word mentoring is the wrong word, discipled Him. The Bible doesn't tell you to mentor anyone, it tells you to disciple people. That's the correct and the right way of expressing it. But Jesus hadn't sat under any of their ministries, and yet they recognized and were amazed that He had amazing knowledge, and yet He hadn't studied under them. He studied under the Heavenly Father. His Father taught Him things. He spent time in His presence. And when you will spend time in the presence of God, it's a massive shortcut to what men can teach you. You can learn from God in a moment that would take you years to do, so that you can do things quicker, sharper, faster, more anointed than you've ever done before. Why take an hour to do something when God can cause you to be able to achieve that within moments? This is how God wants us to be today. So people noticed that Jesus had tremendous learning without having studied, because the Holy Spirit taught Him the things of God. He became a student under the Holy Spirit because He was led, He was directed, He was empowered by the Holy Spirit. He did nothing without the guidance of the Holy Spirit, and neither should we. So Jesus, taught them about this. He said to them, my teaching is not my own. It comes not from me, but the one who sent me. So Jesus is not claiming that any revelation He had originated with Him, but it originated with His Father. How many people today always try to bring a revelation that, they want to be the first to reveal it? Well, there's nothing new under the sun. The Holy Spirit has probably revealed those revelations to other people a long time ago. It's just unpackaging them to you. But they're not yours, they're His revelations. It's like when we read the revelations of John. The revelations of John are really not the revelations of John. The book of Revelations are the revelations of Jesus Christ that God shared with an angel to share with John. So those revelations came to John, but they're the revelations of Jesus Christ. So Jesus isn't claiming any revelation that He had came by His own imagination or His own thinking. They came by revelation from the Father, because He was in touch with His Father. Father revealed things to Him, made things known to Him. And then Jesus said, if anyone chooses to do God's will, he will find out whether I speak on my own. Now listen, what Jesus is really saying at that moment of time, he's saying that he's really that the source of his revelation is available to anyone who chooses to do God's will today. So he's saying it's available to you. And when that source of revelation is available to you, you will know it's the same revelations that Jesus got. Because Jesus wants you to understand the same Holy Spirit that empowered Him, the same Holy Spirit that did the miracles, the same Holy Spirit that revealed the unknown to Him, the unknown about people's lives through the word of knowledge, through discerning of the spirits, showed Him events. That same Holy Spirit is available to you today. And He will work to the same capacity in your life if you would yield the same way that Jesus Christ did. So Jesus is telling people the source of revelation is available to anyone who chooses to do the will of God. That's what he's saying. If you don't choose to do the will of God, why should God give you a revelation? Why does God need to give you a revelation of his word to make people understand the gospel truth if you never share it? Why would God need to give you a revelation if you never live the life that God has called you to give? He'd be wasting his resources on you. Why should God waste those resources on you when you never do anything with them? So Jesus is saying, the one that chooses to do the will of the Father, he's the one who's going to receive the revelation. And he's going to know the revelations I brought have come from the Father, because he's going to tap into the same source, he's going to drink from the same river. That's why you could share something and you think it's unique to you, and then you hear YouTube or someone else comes and preaches and they share exactly what God has laid on your heart, because you're drinking from the same river. It's the same Holy Spirit. So Jesus is basically saying that if you do the will of the Father, you choose to do that, then you'll drink from the same river I'm drinking from. The same revelations will flow into your life, and that same river of God will flow out, that you'll be able to touch other people's lives. And the disciples had taken hold of this truth. That's why these unskilled, uneducated men, who probably had generation after generation of being fishermen, not really not needing to know anything else except their occupation, that's why they could take hold of the truth of God's word and be able to package it and explain it in a way that was far greater than any scribe or Pharisee could understand. Because they spent time in the presence of Jesus, they took hold of that truth. And God wants us to take hold of that truth today. So not only were they empowered with the same Holy Spirit that Jesus was empowered with, they had the same spirit of wisdom and understanding came upon their life because of friendship, because of association with the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, when you spend time with someone, they will say certain things, and you will find that you might even say the same things. You spend time with them, the good traits will start to have an effect upon your life. And because they spent time in the presence of Jesus, and the fact that Jesus is rose and is seated at the right hand of the Father makes no difference. You can still spend time with him. Jesus said, "Be with you always, even to the end of the age." He's with you. So you can talk to him, you can communicate with him, you can still yourself and listen to him and allow him to speak into your life and unfold the scripture. How many of us actually take time when we're reading the word of God to stop and to meditate upon what we're reading? Sometimes we think that we've got to speed read 10 passages a day keeps the devil away. That's not true. It doesn't matter if you read a small portion, if you meditated upon that, thought it over, chewed it through under the influence of the Holy Spirit, it would bring you more revelation than you've ever got before. It will unfold it. We sometimes restrict God and box him in terms of we read the word of God and we highlight particular things or a revelation that's come to us and we stick with that same revelation. But the Bible tells us the word of God is a two-edged sword. There's more than one side to it. So God wants to reveal to you more than you've ever known about that particular portion of scripture. You know, God could do an amazing thing. He could give you one portion of scripture and tell you to preach in it every day of the week. And every day of the week we'd get a different message from it. That's exactly what he does. And he wants to reveal things to you today. But it comes as well. The anointing of God, there are different ways to receive that anointing, that impartation of the goodness of God in your life, that power of God to do the things he wants you to do. There's more than one way of receiving it, but one of the ways is association. And so as you spend time in the presence of Jesus Christ, as you associate with him, it will make a difference in your life. The Bible tells us that these religious leaders took note. They took note because he had been with Jesus. When was the last time anybody took note because you had been with Jesus? They don't. Because we don't allow that relationship to have the priority and the true place, a paramount place in our life that it should. But if we allow that relationship to take a true hold upon your life, then people will know that you've been with Jesus. They'll know who you are. Not you've been to church. Anyone can go to church. People in all religions can turn up at churches. But it's about spending time in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. If you really desire to be more like Jesus, you'd spend time with him. You'd spend time in his company. You know, he longs to spend time in the company with you. I'd go as far as to say he has a secret place for you. A secret place where he could encounter you. And sometimes we keep him waiting. We only ever enter that place every occasionally. But he wants you to encounter him on a regular basis. Jesus never went a day, a moment, in broken fellowship with his Father until he went to Calvary's cross. That was when it happened. Well, in fact, in the Garden of Gethsemane, the Bible tells it was Satan's hour. And so the onslaught began. But prior to that, Jesus never had broken fellowship with his Father. He had such a wonderful relationship. And Jesus continually spoke about his Father on a regular basis. I and my Father am one in my Father's house. Jesus was absolutely besotted with his Father. And that's the type of love that God wants us to have today. And that type of love can be imparted into your life. It can start to grow in your life, start to become your life if you spend time in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. He wants you to find a place of intimacy and amazing friendship with him. These disciples knew the presence, the power of God, the wisdom of God, the working of the Holy Spirit within their life because they spent time in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. In that place where we can impart his life, his nature, his ministry, his character in you. All the way through the Word of God, you will find that there's impartation through association. And God wants you to understand this. The Bible tells us that God commissioned Joshua. He commissioned Joshua, son of Nun, to take over from Moses. And so the Bible says he was filled with the spirit of wisdom because Moses had laid his hands on him. And all Israel listened to him and did what the Lord had commanded Moses. So the Bible is really telling us that Joshua had an impartation of that spirit of wisdom because Moses laid his hands upon him. Moses never decreased in power or wisdom when he laid his hands upon him, but something was transferred. And so touch, association, can cause a transfer of anointing upon another person's life. Remember last week when we were talking about the virtue of Jesus, and we were saying that virtue doesn't just mean that power, that explosive power, that dynamite power, that ability to do, but it also means, you know, a moral excellence and a holiness. People was touching Jesus because virtue was flowing from them. Life was transformed as a result. Not only did sickness go from bodies, but I believe that a moral excellence started to take place within people's lives, that they sought to live a holy life. Joshua was someone who the Lord was commissioning to be the next in line when Moses was to go home. And so he needed the wisdom of God to lead the people of God into the land of promise. And so the Bible tells us that Moses laid hands upon him, and that spirit of wisdom, the spirit of God, flowed through him. So there was transference at a touch. Look, there's diseases in the world today, and people are always conscious of transference through touches, coughing, sneezing, etc. But if a disease can transfer like that, how much more the presence of God? And God is greater than any disease. In fact, if you've got the presence of God upon you, it'll eradicate those diseases if you believe that truth. The Word of God is the greatest immune system you could ever have. So we need to rely upon the living God and allow him to move in our life. So Joshua was changed. Think of King David. King David is basically living as an outcast, because even though he's got the promise of God that he's the rightful king over the nation of Israel, someone else is occupying the throne. And sometimes God may call you into a position, but someone else is occupying it. But during that time, there's a training, there's an equipping for you to fulfill that role. The time will come. But David is living as an outcast at that moment in time. And so the Bible tells us that other outcasts joined David, people in debt, people that were marginalized, problem type people joined David. And the Bible tells us he took all these rogues and all these vagabonds and all these people that were outcast and marginalized, and he molded them and he made them not just into an army, but they became the mighty men of God, David's mighty men. So there was a shaping of them. Now they associated with David, in whom God's favor rested. So when David came into his inheritance, they came into theirs as well. And so through association, they was greatly blessed. And this is what I'm saying, that when you associate, those who walk with the wise become wise. When there's association, proper godly association, there's impartation of not just, you know, spiritual gifting and anointing, but there's impartation of favor, and the benefits of that relationship start to come your way. And David's men entered into theirs. They were shaped, they were molded, they were changed. So when David came and was positioned as king, they came into their rightful positions as well. They received positions within that kingdom, and they fulfilled their own destiny. Where did they fulfill, why did they fulfill the destiny? Because they associated with God's man. And it changes their life. In fact, you could go as far as to say, all the people that killed giants around the time of David, all associated with David. David was known as a giant killer, wasn't he? So that same sort of anointing that was upon his life to slay those giants was upon their life as well. And so there's a transference because of association. You ever read in the Word of God where the Bible tells us when when God spoke to the prophet Elijah, and he said, go and anoint Elisha to be, you know, the next prophet to the nation of Israel. And so he's anointed, and he leaves his place, and he becomes his servant. When he became his servant, he served him for many, many years. It was almost like an apprenticeship, a discipleship. So Elijah was teaching Elijah to be the next in rank, to be a great man of God. And he associated with him every day, poured water on his feet, he served him, he stuck with him. And because of association, because he didn't allow a division in his relationship with him, a break in that relationship, because he was associated with him, because he stayed with him continuously, he saw the very moment that he was promised, if you see the moment that I leave, what you have asked will be yours. And he asked for a double portion, to be twice the man that his master was. And he said, if you see, you'll receive it. In fact, he told him it was a hard thing. He didn't say it was impossible. And he tried in the natural to shake him off. I'm going to this place, I'm going to that place. You stay here. And he wouldn't have it. He kept that association going. He didn't allow circumstances or events to change things. He stayed in the environment where God could reach him and bless him. And you've got to be a person that stays in the environment where God can reach you and bless you. Stay in the presence of Jesus. Don't lose fellowship with Jesus. Don't lose sight of him. So Elijah stayed in the presence of Elijah. And he saw him. He supernaturally saw the chariots of God, that whirlwind coming for his master, and that mantle fall to the ground. And he picked up that mantle, and he said, where is the Elijah of God? And he parted the River Jordan. A supernatural act, just like Elijah had done. So there was a transference of anointing, a transference of power. The mantle, folks, was just representative of the anointing of God. We sometimes think it's some magical cloak. It's not a magical cloak. It represented a transference of the anointing of God. He was now going to walk differently and wear the anointing of God to be a prophet to the nation. But it came because of association. It came because he stayed in the environment where God could reach him and God could bless him in a wonderful way. And this is what God is looking for today. The Bible even tells us on one occasion when King Saul was really looking to kill David. And so he sent soldiers, and they came upon a school of prophets, and they ended up prophesying. And so he sent other soldiers, and they ended up prophesying as well. So finally he went himself, came under the Spirit of God, ended up prophesying, and lay on the floor all day and night, under the influence of the presence of God. What happened? Because the school of prophets was worshipping the living God and prophesying, he came into that environment, into that atmosphere that changed him. And we're going to come into an atmosphere of the presence of God where it absolutely transforms our life and changes us so that we're unrecognizable. The great thing about the presence of God, it does leave you wanting more. You don't just take the presence of God and say, that was wonderful, and, you know, I'm satisfied now. It's not like having a good meal and you say, that'll do me till tomorrow. It leaves you wanting more of his presence. And that's how God wants you to be. But it comes through that environment. Many believers don't experience the atmosphere. You've heard people talk about an event and say, you needed to be there, the atmosphere. Well, sometimes people treat church and just think, well, I can watch it online. But there's nothing quite like about coming, meeting together, atmosphere of the presence of God when he moves. Someone on a video may see it, or see the presence of God moving, his effect upon people's lives, but often they don't encounter the same atmosphere as if they were there. So environment, atmosphere, association will all start to bring impartation of the presence of God within your life, so you can be the person that God has made you to be. He's made you for a plan and purpose. You see, sometimes people are seeking, aren't they? I want the anointing of Smith Wigglesworth. I want the anointing of John G. Lake. Well, it's good that you want something of the qualities that them men of God are. But what about the anointing that God wanted you to have, the person he wanted you to be? There's no one, you know, no one quite like, say, Angela Davis. Because there's anointing there. You don't have to seek the anointing of someone else, because God has a unique anointing for you. So you've got to seek that out, so you can be the best person that God wants you to be. Not be a copy of someone else, because they preach a certain way, you try to preach that way. Because they use their hands a certain way, you try to use your hands that way. Even trying to mimic the voices. You've just been a replica. That's not uniqueness. You know, when God created us, we weren't created on like Toyota's production line and we all come off exactly the same. Every one of us are unique with a particular calling, because the Bible says that he created us for good works in Christ Jesus. So you were created for a particular good work that I cannot do. Or even if I did do it, it's not what God has called me to do, it's what God's called you to do. So you're going to be the person that God has called you to be. And feel free to do that. You don't have to copy anyone else. The Bible tells us that we're being transformed as we yield to the Lord Jesus, to the Holy Spirit. We're being transformed to be more like Jesus. Paul prayed for the Galatian church, and pray again that Christ be formed in you, because he'd moved away from what God wanted. So he'd want to see Christ formed in them. So if there's anyone you should replicate, it should be the Lord Jesus Christ. But even when he's working through your life, the uniqueness of who you are, he does not remove. Because he loves you and he cares for you. He just wants you to be the person he's destined you to be. If you spend time with people that walk in holiness, you will find it will start to change your life. You spend time in the wrong company, all of their habits are going to pick up on you. You've got to be very, very careful of who you associate with. So spend time in the presence of God. Seek him out. Talk to him. Ask him about situations, everything that you go through. And he will help you in a tremendous way. It's like when you're learning. I went for a period when I worked at British Aerospace. I had to do, for courses I did, I had to do a lot of study. But you couldn't do your study in your work because you was working. So that's all outside of work. But you had to do assignments and projects. And the projects had to be ones that you presented before the company management that was selling it to them, that say this project will make this company money. So it had to do well. So how do you go about that? You start to do the work, but you pray and you ask God that it doesn't absorb all your time, all your energy, but you have supernatural help to have a real understanding of things. Daniel had a spirit where he could understand any riddle. Anything that was posed to him, he could understand. Where did he get that spirit from? From associating with his Heavenly Father. He had the holy habit. No one was busier than Daniel. Daniel served the Lord under three administrations of different kings. And he had the highest position. And yet, three times a day, he sought the Lord out. He sought his presence out. Sometimes when you are too busy, you've got to stop. Seek the presence of God out. You have no time. You need to seek him out. And when you seek him out, you will find you have more time for the other things. The information you need comes quicker. Your ability to do things is a lot faster simply because of his presence. It comes from associating with him. We need to be people that associate. Bible says iron sharpens iron. So as a church of the Lord Jesus Christ, we need to be together because we encourage each other, we build each other up. If one falls down, another one is able to lift them up. So we need the body of Christ. You need encouraging, someone encourages you. They need encouraging, you encourage them. So the body of Christ works together through that association together. We help each other, we're growing the things of God. We share the things of God together. We share the testimony of Jesus, the things that God is showing us together, the things that we've learned, the things of God, and the things that you have learned when you share with someone else. You know, that penny may drop and they may have that light bulb moment and go, wow, you know what? I'm embracing that. And this is what God wants. But it comes through association. We're better together than alone. So he wants us to be people that receive from him. You never can encounter the Lord Jesus Christ without receiving something from him, without being changed in some way. So let's be people that seek him out, seek that, impartation through association with the one that laid down his life that you might take it all. So let's pray right now, and we'll trust the Lord to move in his mighty power within our life. Thank you, Father. Father, we don't know why, but we just give you thanks and praise that he was willing to associate with us. That, Lord, even when our relationship was lost, you came and you found us. You did something about it. And I give you all the glory. Father, I thank you that even in the garden, when Adam sinned, it wasn't Adam who sought you out, you sought him out. Your desire to encounter us, to associate with us, is greater, Father, than our desire for you. And I pray that you would change that, Father, that we would have a burning desire and a passion to meet you. And as we meet with you, things would start to change in our life, that we'd reflect the glory of your Son, and people would take note that we have been with Jesus. We give you glory tonight, and we thank you, Father God. And we just want to honor your name in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Will you be blessed if you do?